Hi, folks. Well, we're at the seventh and final church. It's called Laodicea. It begins at Revelation chapter 3, verse 14. At this church, we are going to discover the Spirit, the last of God's sevenfold Spirit, which is the Spirit of fire. Now, fire is an interesting thing. After God had destroyed the earth the first time with the deluge of water, he said never again would he do that, destroy the earth with a flood of water. Never again. But he does say that he will destroy it with fire. So there's fire coming. Well, you get a lot of television shows and movies made and everything, you know, where the fire of God falls and it's an asteroid coming down upon the earth, or it's forest fires, or all kinds of things, you know. It's Jeremiah 5 and 14 gives us what I consider one of the better explanations, definitions of the fire of God. In those verses, it says, let me just look it up. Jeremiah 5, I think it's 14. Poor old Bible's getting wore out. You press the buttons, but nothing happens, eh? This is what it says. Therefore, this is what the Lord God Almighty says. Because the people have spoken these words, I will make my words in your mouth a fire, and these people the wood it consumes. Now, of course, here the Lord is talking to Jeremiah, and the people are denying what Jeremiah has said about the Lord. Jeremiah is a prophet of God, and well, there's lots of people who don't quite believe that. And so God's telling Jeremiah that he's sending him to the people again, and he's saying, you know, he says, go ahead. My word in your mouth, Jeremiah, is going to be a fire. And these people who reject it are going to be the wood the fire consumes. Now, there's a good analogy there, you know. You put a match to a stick of wood and see what happens. Well, it burns to a crisp and it's no longer good for anything. So the fire of God, we know that the Word of God is truth. Okay. So the fire of God then, the truth coming out of Jeremiah's mouth, would have to be the truth revealed, wouldn't it? Because all of Jeremiah's prophecies did come to pass. Still do. Don't forget, these are eternal prophecies. The prophecies contained in the Old Testament are not something that happened, you know, 6,000 years ago and they're going to happen again. No, they're eternal prophecies. They're the Word of God. So, they are applicable in every generation. They don't cease to exist. Can the understanding of them come to a conclusion? Yes. Once you understand them, you understand them. That's it. That's all. Prophecy ends. But in the course of growing to understand them, so the truth revealed is the fire of God. Another place it talks about how the Lord, and the Lord comes, both Old and New Testaments, when he comes, sword proceeds from his mouth. The sword, we are told, is the Word of God. And we are also told that Word of God is the Scriptures, the prophecy given in the Old Testament concerning God, his people, the devil, his destruction, salvation, deliverance. All of these things are in the Old Testament. In fact, the whole book of Revelation is in the Old Testament. Did I say 3:14 Revelation? Yes. So here at Laodicea, the final church, the spirit of fire. Remember, we were born at Ephesus. We came to recognize our Creator at Smyrna. We grew to fear His, what He wants, what He says. Fear Him. Show respect. I'm gonna take the time to go here. Perhaps I shouldn't, but I'm gonna take the time. I think it's really, really important. There's lots of people who say you don't have to fear God. Let me give you another example. I've done this before. We went through it at Pergamum, the Church of Pergamum. Pergamum, as a matter of fact, has got the least views of all of the church videos. Isn't that interesting, eh? one of the most important churches and got the least views. Yeah, that makes sense. The spirit at the third church of Pergamum is this knowledge of great God's grace, and that Jesus is Lord, truth, leads us to fear God, the fear of the Lord. If you're a mechanic and you're building a motor, and in the course of checking things out, maybe on the label, for example, under the hood, it says that timing is set at 10 degrees before top dead center. Okay. But in your own mind, you've got the engine built and you're looking at this before top dead center and you're thinking, well, why would you want the spark to take place before the piston gets to the top of its stroke? You know, the piston goes up. When it hits the top, you'd think you'd want it to fire to drive it back down. Well, it actually, at 10 degrees, setting the timing at 10 degrees before top dead center is at 10 degrees right here instead of here. That's where it fires. And you think, well, that doesn't make sense to me. So you set it at top dead center. You fired up. Can that create a problem? Yeah, it sure can. It sure can. You see, in the course of the people designing the engine, it's discovered that things take time. It takes time for electricity to move from the coil to the distributor, for example. It takes time. It may not be much time, but it takes time. It takes time for the electricity to go through the spark plug and jump that arc. Not much time, but it takes time. Everything has to be taken into account, because that engine turning at, let's say 4, 5, 6,000 RPM, revolutions per minute, wow. There's a lot of sparks taking place. You know what I mean? If it takes time, then the reason it's set before top dead center is so that that piston has opportunity to be at top dead center, or just past top dead center, when it actually fires. You don't want the spark firing too late. Because if you have a combustion changer full of fuel and the piston's already on the downstroke, at 6,000 RPM, it could drive that piston right through the bottom of the oil pan, right, break the crank and everything. it could be a dangerous situation. It could ruin your engine. So the timing is not just a suggestion. The timing is, it's there for a reason. Why that timing is set where it is. It's to protect the engine. It's to make everything work right. People will argue, oh, you got lots of leeway and everything. Yeah, well, yeah, there is. But it's not the perfect point, is it? The perfect point is what the factory sets it at. If you want that engine to last 100,000 miles, if you want it to get the mileage it's supposed to get, you know, all of these things are taken into account by the designers. And the designers put their design in a manual. And when you open that manual, and the manual says 10 degrees before top dead center, 7 degrees, whatever the manual says, is where that engine is designed to fire. So that the ignition takes place at the proper positioning of the piston in the cylinder. So if you're dealing with the more refined an engine becomes, the more specific all the numbers have to be. The tolerances have to be tighter. Everything, from bearings, you know, timing, valve timing, everything has to be tighter. There's less room for, error. There's less movement for error. So in tightening everything up, and pulling all the strings together, you might say in girding up that belt of truth around your waist so your pants don't fall off, the tolerances are tight. They're tight. So if the manual says this is where it should be set, do you not fear that? Knowing the ramifications of not setting it where it's supposed to be? Do you not fear that manual, what it says? You're an idiot if you don't. It's the engineers have put those specifications there to protect you and your engine. They're not suggestions. Everything is there to help you. And you don't fear it? Well, if people don't fear the manual, then they start monkeying. Oh, well, I can push it this way or that way. You know, it says top dead center. It says before top dead center. I can push it after top dead center. Yeah, well, try that. Put it out on the track and see how long it lasts when you put the power to it. Go ahead. You wonder why things explode? That's why. Why things are not, don't last? That's why. Because people don't fear the truth, do they? The truth is in the manual. But people don't fear it. I don't have to fear God. God is love. You're an idiot. If you don't fear God, you're an absolute idiot. In the same way as the idiot goes to the track with his brand new engine, he's put $20,000, $30,000 into it, he takes it to the track, he puts the friggin' power to her, and it explodes. Oh, what happened? Must have been metal fatigue. Yeah, not metal fatigue, mental fatigue. Mistakes were made. Something wasn't done right. You x-ray a block to find a crack, to find metal fatigue, rods or whatever. Did you do all that? No. I thought, you know, I trusted the manufacturer. Maybe you shouldn't have. Maybe you should have checked it out. Always a mistake somewhere. So to not fear God, that's just absolute craziness. Craziness. And at Pergamum, you know, a child recognizes his creator, his mom and dad, truth and love. And the child comes to say, you know, to himself, I better pay attention to what mom and dad tells me. I better obey, because there'll be discipline involved if I don't. Yeah, that's right, there will be. We spoke of that as well in the curse at Pergamum, didn't we? At Thyatira, we discovered how are we doing here? Yeah. At Thyatira, we discovered wisdom and understanding, the spirit of wisdom and understanding. And how not we don't get our wisdom and understanding from the knowledge of good and evil. We get our wisdom and understanding from the tree of life. You better learn the difference between the two. What comes from God and what comes from man. And this is where we run into that bitch Jezebel and that kind of an attitude, you know. I think it, therefore I am. You know. Well, God told me. Yeah, well, bullshit. Simply put, bullshit. God didn't tell you nothing. They make their pronunciations. Thus saith the word of the Lord. God told me. And their pronunciations contradict what the manual says. Well, why do they do? They don't fear the manual, do they? They don't fear God's word. They don't fear God. And that's why they do it. So at Thyatira, we learned how not to mess with that kind of crap. At Smyrna? No, at Sardis. Excuse me. Smyrna is the second church. Sardis is the fifth church. We learned that judgment, yeah, every choice we make is a judgment. No question about it. And God does judge. And we are judged by the Word, because when the Word is presented to us, if we accept it, we're blessed by it. If we reject it, well, there's a curse, isn't there? And that curse can take away our salvation. And it's of our own choice. It's not someone else interrupting us and taking our salvation from us. It's us pissing it away. We don't care anymore. So we learned how to properly judge at Sardis. And then at Philadelphia, the spirit of counsel and power. We learned what these things reflective of, wisdom and understanding. Wise counsel comes from a wise man. Power is understanding that wisdom. Power is the gospel. So we've grown, haven't we, from birth at Ephesus all the way through to where now we're graduating. We are trained up in the way that we should go, and we graduate at the sixth church of counsel and power. The gospel is in us. At the end of Philadelphia, the gospel is in us. There's no question about it. If we've done all these things properly, listened to the word counsel God has given us in His word, the Spirit is in us, the truth is in us. Here we stand. We are mature. We're graduating. Now what are we going to do with it? As I said at Philadelphia, what we do with it is what can happen to us at Laodicea. The seventh, spirit of fire. Let me read it to you. Remember, look for the blessing, look for the curse. If something is said that's positive, think of the opposite. That's the negative, that's the curse. Think of the opposite. The Church of Laodicea, to the angel of the Church of Laodicea write, these are the words of the Amen, the faithful and true witness, the ruler of God's creation. I know your deeds, that you are neither cold nor hot. I wish you were either one or the other. So because you are lukewarm, neither hot nor cold, I am about to spit you out of my mouth. You say, I am rich, I have acquired wealth, and do not need a thing. But you do not realize that you are wretched, pitiful, poor, blind, and naked. I counsel you to buy from me gold refined in the fire, so that you may become rich, and white clothes to wear, so you can cover your shameful nakedness, and salve to put on your eyes, so that you can see. Those whom I love, I rebuke and discipline. So be earnest and repent. Here I am. I stand at the door and knock. If anyone hears my voice and opens the door, I will come in and eat with him and he with me. To him who overcomes, I will give the right to sit with me on my throne, just as I overcame and sat down with my Father on his throne. He who has an ear, let him hear what the Spirit says to the churches. And that's the angel of the Church of Laodicea. These are the words of the Amen. To say Amen when someone makes a statement and the audience replies Amen, or the hearer replies Amen to the statement, it means so be it. It means fixed. It means righteous. Agreement. The faithful and true witness, the ruler of God's creation. This is Jesus. I know your deeds, that you are neither cold nor hot. I wish you were either one or the other. What? God wishes we were cold? In my worldly opinion, I would think, well, that's crazy. God wants us all to be hot for the Lord. Hot to trot for God. You know what I mean? It's not wise to be hot to trot for God if you haven't taken the time to learn from God. It's nice that a person goes out into the world and they want to be, I don't know, a dentist, a doctor, a mechanic, whatever. But you better go into training first before you start thinking that you're a professional journeyman. We don't let people practice medicine on other people without a license. And you have to go to school to get the license. No. You let quacks work on you? I don't think so. You want Jim next door to operate on you? I don't think so. I know your deeds, that you are neither cold nor hot. So you've got people who are cold. They don't purport to know anything. They're very quiet. In most instances, they will tell you, I don't talk about religion. I keep that to myself. That's my personal preference. Interesting. And you have other people who are so excited to go out and tell the world, you know. They think they know. They think they're, I don't know, maybe some, I've seen it so often, so I make mention of this, you know, that some minister or some guy in church told them when they were little that they were going to be preachers of the gospel, you know, they're going to be men of God or prophets or whatever, you know, and they hold this in their heart for ages, years, in many cases a lifetime, and they're anxious, they think they know something, and off they go, you know, and God, he's in favor of that. But better you go into training first before you run off to... And the cold ones, you know, I don't know. I don't know nothing. Well, God understands that too. He understands. If people are not touched, if no one is sent, if no harvesters stop by to help us understand. So he wishes we were one or the other, you know, either be hot or be cold, but then you get the ones who sit in the middle. They're the self-righteous ones. You know, the hot ones, they're hot to trot for God, and the cold ones, well, they don't want to say nothing. And the lukewarm ones, they're an interesting breed for sure. They say they're rich, you know. Oh, yeah, like, look what I've done in my life, you know. I got a nice home, I raised my family, and everything's good, you know. I got a good pension, or I've got a good job, and I get along with just fine, you know what I mean? And I know God and everything, I'm saved and blood-bought, born again, going to heaven, everything's just hunky-dory, you know what I mean? Oh, they're a dangerous bunch. They're fence-sitters. They're not hot for God, but neither are they cold towards God. They're fence-sitters. Well, I don't want to say anything, you know. Yeah, in church on Sunday, I'll stand up there and I'll tell everybody what I think, you know, amongst my own people. But on Monday when they get to work, or on their way to work, or when they're sitting in the coffee shop, or with their friends, or when they're out on the weekend with the boys, you know, oh, well, we don't talk about God then. The fence sitters. They're 99% of the population of Christians. They're fence sitters. What does God say about them? He says, you don't even realize that you're wretched, pitiful, poor, blind, and naked. Oh, crap. They don't even realize it. Why? Because they ignored all the other churches. Oh, yeah, they were born and raised Christians, you know, in a Christian home, and they know about Jesus. And, oh, yeah, I'm a Christian. You know, you ask them, are you a Christian? Oh, yeah, I'm a Christian. They kind of... Not a good place to be. That's just not a good place to be. If you're interested... Look up the word wretched in a search box. Pick your translation, as I've told you before. Go on the internet, go to a Bible site, Bible Online, something like that. Pick the translation you want to read from. Pick them all. If you've got the time, want to put the effort in, read them all the translations, what they have to say. And just punch in the word wretched. And read everything in the scriptures where it talks, uses that word wretched. I guarantee you, you're going to learn something you didn't know before. I guarantee it. Punch in the word poor. I guarantee you're going to learn something you didn't know before. Pitiful. Punch it in. Read about it. See when the Bible uses that word pitiful. What's it talking about? Blind. See what it is to be blind. Always remember the two sides to wisdom. There's the esoteric and the exoteric. The literal, you know, blind. Okay, the poor dude's got no eyesight. You know? You can't see with these at all. But then there's the esoteric, you know, spiritual blindness. In other words, blind in the mind and heart. They can't see it. So we're wretched, pitiful, poor, blind, and naked. Look them all up. Look up the word salve and find out what salve is.
Salve? Not stupid, Ed. Salve is what you get in a tin and you put it on a wound, you know, and everything.
Yeah, really? Yeah, okay. That's the exoteric, that's the literal definition of the word salve. Does the Bible have another definition for the word salve that has nothing to do with the flesh? that has only something to do with the mind and heart? And the answer is yes, it does. It does. And remember, this is the Word of God. He ain't talking about literal flesh. He's speaking to your mind and heart, so we better know what that salve is that we should put on our eyes. It heals. So because you are lukewarm, neither hot nor cold, I'm about to spit you out of my mouth. Is that a good thing? Well, let's find out. Say you were rich, acquired wealth, need nothing, but you do not realize that you're wretched, pitiful, poor, blind, and naked. I counsel you to buy from me gold, refined in the fire. Well, the fire is the truth revealed. What's this gold? All through the scriptures, the gold that God speaks of is wisdom. From God. Not from the knowledge of good and evil, but from the tree of life. Wisdom from God. The esoteric. So you can become rich. And white clothes to wear. We've spoken of this before, the white linen. So you can cover your shameful nakedness. What is this nakedness he speaks of? Ignorance. There's nothing worse than a person parading their nakedness. If a bunch of queers walk down Yonge Street in Toronto with their dicks hanging out in a gay pride parade, people will tolerate that. People will even applaud it. As disgusting as it is. But you know, it's just as disgusting to claim to know and preach the gospel of Jesus Christ when you don't. That's just as disgusting. He says, those who I love, I rebuke and discipline. Oh, but God is love. He don't discipline nobody. We don't have to fear God. No? Well, if he disciplines, I'd suggest you fear it. It can be really harsh. So be innocent and replant. Stand at the door and knock. He says, to him who overcomes, I will give the right to sit with me on my throne. And to him who doesn't overcome, you don't get to sit with him on his throne. If you don't get to sit with him on his throne, where are you? Well, the scriptures tell us you're cast away into utter darkness. Oh, whoopee. That sounds like fun, doesn't it? No, it's not. So the curse, of course, the blessing is that we get in this church is that we get to sit down with God on the throne of David. That's the throne of authority. And the curse is that we don't. The blessing is that God sits down with us and eats with us and we with him. And if we don't, he'll tell you nothing. You'll eat nothing. You will starve. The famine will be so great. Boy, it's already here, isn't it? Because it's not a famine for food you put in your yap. It's a famine for hearing the true word of the Lord. Amos, I'm guessing, 8:11, I think. Check it. Laodicea. It's a scary church, too. It's funny how you can read the manual and you can say, well, praise God, look at that. It tells me everything I need to know. If I just follow the manual, if I just stick with the specifications given in the manual and don't mess and monkey with anything, I'm going to have a very good little engine. But when it comes to God's manual, the Bible, the Old and New Testaments, the two witnesses, Moses and Elijah, the man of law and the man of faith? They walk away from it. They won't listen to it. It's okay with me. I don't like being around people like that. I remember I worked many, many years in a place where in corrections, you weren't supposed to talk about God or religion or anything like that. You talk about sports, the weather, that's it, with inmates, you know. And they always hold that. They still to this day hold that discipline within corrections. I got lots of reprimands in my file, I'll tell you. Because I don't hold to that at all. If I can't talk about God, I don't belong there. And if some idiot thinks he's going to tell me I can't talk about God to anybody I choose to talk about God with, well, guess what? Reprimand's just a piece of paper written by some man. And I left corrections. Corrections didn't kick me out. What do we do with what we have? The spirit of fire. What do we do with what we have? Are we mice or are we men? Are we men of God? Or are we men of the world? No different than every other clown that walks through the atmosphere. What do we do with it? We've been trained up. We understand. Now what do we do with it? Are we bold? Or are we a bunch of scaredy cats? Well, people will think I'm weird. Who cares? God won't think you're weird. If you're eager to say a word for the Lord in conversation, if you're eager to live for God, rather than for man. Oh, but if I don't participate with my buddies, I mean, they're going to ostracize me. Who cares? If I don't agree with everybody else, well, you know, they're going to say I'm a troublemaker. Well, if you're disagreeing because there's something wrong with what other people are saying and doing that doesn't line up with what God's Word says, then who cares if they ostracize you or not? Rebuke them. Don't suck up to a bunch of liars. And don't kiss Satan's ass. It ain't right. We're supposed to stand and do something with what God has given us. Jesus said, I'm sending you out like sheaves among a pack of wolves. And people will do everything they can to tear you to pieces. They'll scatter you. They'll hamstring you. They'll try to cut the ground out from underneath you in order to protect themselves. From what? From God. I'm not saying I'm God. When the truth comes, judgment falls. Don't forget that. When the truth comes, judgment falls. And the saints do judge the world. Time to go into training if we're not already trained, or time to pick up dress ourselves as warriors and go to war. Go into battle. Be as gentle as doves, but be as shrewd as serpents, knowing full well
that in your stepping out of the norm and being that person who's willing to defend God, do it gently. We're not talking about going out and acting like an asshole. We're just talking about being gentle as a dove, but as shrewd as a serpent. Time to start judging. I hope it's all helped. Boy, we can keep going on this one. I don't know if I will or not, but we'll see how it goes. Don't forget, Jesus is Lord. Love one another. Bye for now.